What we want to do after a baby is born is we want to stabilize the child, make sure that there are no other organs involved, because there are other associated anomalies in some children. We want to make sure that there are no genetic issues that we need to address. We want to make sure all the other organ systems are as good as they can be and assess them if we have to. And then once that is done, then it's more a matter of scheduling the surgery.
For many children with complex heart disease, there's blockage of the blood either going to the body or to the lungs. And there's a blood vessel called the ductus arteriosus, which connects those two arteries. Everybody has one, and it usually closes after birth.
You can keep that blood vessel open with a medication called prostaglandins. And so, therefore, by giving a baby prostaglandins, you're actually replicating the same physiology that it had in the uterus when it was very stable to when it's outside the uterus.
So instead of having a child come in critically ill where there was nothing we could do, we can stabilize these children, do diagnostic procedures, and then have a stable child who goes for surgery.
If you just leave a child with this circulation for a period of time, then they end up going into heart failure because so much blood goes to the lungs in a circle that they end up in heart failure. So you have to walk a balance between the two. You have to have the ductus open and can eventually control how much blood goes to the lungs. That's why the operation is done usually in the first week of life.
Through our experience with hypoplastic left heart syndrome in the fetus, we've been able to identify a variety of factors which function as risk factors for outcome. For these patients.
One of the things that can cause a real problem is when there's blockage to blood flow from the lungs getting back to the heart.
There are rare children who have what's called an intact atrial septum. And these children are the most difficult to deal with hypoplastic left heart syndrome.
In hypoplastic left heart syndrome, the blood that comes back from the lungs comes to the left side of the heart. But because there's only one pumping chamber, it has to cross over to the right side of the heart, inside the heart, to be able to pump out. That's normally done through a hole in the wall between the two upper chambers of the heart, called the foramen ovale. Some children we see where there's a very tiny hole and the hole is restrictive. Sometimes we can see where there is no hole and the atrial septum is completely closed.
This complete closure of the partition between the upper chambers of the heart means that blood that gets back to the left side of the heart can't go anywhere.
That results in an increased backup pressure on the pulmonary veins.
So right after birth, we have to do something very quickly to open up that partition.
And the way that's done is by passing a catheter across the atrial septum, blowing a small balloon up.
And you pull it back very quickly and you literally rip a hole between the two upper chambers. That allows the blue and the red blood to mix now, and then the children become much pinker, they have oxygen in their bloodstream and they're stabilized so that they can basically survive till they can have surgery.
And that can allow the resistance in the lungs to drop enough to consider the stage one operation, usually after 5 or 6 days.
Oftentimes, even when these babies are born and we immediately open the atrial septum, there can already be difficulties with the way the lungs have formed, and that can add a risk to these patients. We know also from our experience that if there are any extra cardiac abnormalities besides the heart disease itself, that can add risk to the reconstruction of the heart in HLHS. And we also know that if there's a known genetic abnormality, that can add risk. And then finally, there's the issue of prematurity. Although we're now able to care for babies with HLHS very, very well, that are very small, if there is significant prematurity and immaturity, or lack of normal development of the lungs and other organ systems, that can add significant risk to the overall operation.
So if an amniocentesis test hasn't been done, or a chorionic villus sampling test hasn't been done prior to the patient being referred, then we can help to coordinate that either with the referring doctor, or we can take primary responsibility for getting that testing done here.